Grave Encounters is an overview of our current situation 2 years after introducing photogrammetry as the primary method for recording medieval and post-medieval burials at Wessex Archaeology. In this presentation, we shall be discussing our methodology, a few case studies, successes and failures, problems that we've encountered, and how we have overcome them. I'll start off with a quote by John McCarthy. The contractual, financial, and time constraints faced by commercial units has limited our ability and willingness to undertake experimental surveying techniques which carry a higher risk of failure. Now, many things in commercial archaeology have changed since then, so let's see how we have challenged this premise.
So, democratization is defined as the action of making something accessible to everyone. The increase in processing power of computers, more powerful digital cameras, and more readily accessible software have all contributed to the democratisation of photogrammetry. At Wessex Archaeology, we've taken advantage of this development and created a methodology that makes photogrammetry available to all of our field staff, taking it out of the specialist realm and into the universal realm. The advent of the democratisation of photogrammetry at Wessex began in December 2016 with an experiment conducted by the geomatics team at Bulford Camp. The investigation aimed at comparing four techniques as methods for recording burials. These were terrestrial laser scanning, photogrammetry, rectified photography, and hand planning. While there have been numerous comparative studies on these four recording techniques, this investigation stemmed from a desire to understand which one was best suited for use on commercial projects. The following parameters called for the production of an accurate, high quality record in the most timely and cost-efficient manner possible, while also considering the availability of equipment. In this experiment, plans of buried remains were compared using three categories: accuracy, positioning, and completeness, with laser scan data in blue, used as a benchmark for measurements as it's the only one with a strictly defined accuracy. Hand plans in green were found to be the least accurate and were the least complete. I'd like to note that the plans we used in this experiment were extreme examples, but they do give an indication of how incomplete and inaccurate the record can be if drawn by inexperienced field staff. Rectified photography in black was found to be more accurate than hand planning, but while offering a simpler field methodology, certain complications make it a less than desirable method. These complications include the fact that buried remains are not always on a flat plane, and that large burials may require two photos to rectify rather than one. Photogrammetry in red was shown to be highly accurate, a close second to laser scanning. It was visibly desirable to draw from, and also offered a simple field methodology. You can guess which method was the winner. As a result of the experiment, in mid-2017, photogrammetry was first adopted as the main recording technique for medieval and post-medieval burials on a large-scale project, the Chapel Riverside development in Southampton, where the remains of 117 inhumation burials were recovered during the excavation of the remnants of a cemetery. This next section will take you through how we employed this technique on a larger scale, starting with equipment. Most of the equipment on this list is standard to every Wessex Archaeology excavation and evaluation. The photogrammetry register, to the left of the slide, was created to provide us with the necessary information from site to process every burial in the office. This comprises initial and date, camera and photo numbers, context numbers, georeference target numbers, and associated GPS point IDs. Now, staff training is important to the development of skills on site and to building an experienced field team. Training is available to all our site staff and can be provided either in the office or on site. We've seen some remarkable results in the past year from our field staff, who have significantly improved their photographic skills from both practice and training. These images are from a recent training session held at Canongate Kirk in Edinburgh and the resultant model. In addition to training, a manual is handed out to field staff to provide them with a rough guide while they're out on site. It isn't possible to cover every variable or lighting condition one might encounter while taking photographs, and the guide isn't meant to be a cheat sheet. It is meant to enhance the field team's familiarity with using manual settings on a camera and to assist them in making their own decisions about which settings to use. This has been an essential tool for our site staff. So far we've covered equipment, training and reference materials. The result, as these photos show, is science staff proficient in recording photogrammetry both handheld and with a tripod. In the field, time of execution generally takes around 15 to 30 minutes with all due preparation required. Comparably, we have estimated the average time of execution for hand planning on site is about 2 to 4 hours, but this is variable depending on site conditions and drawing skill. The following field workflow is the sequence of tasks our field staff follow when they are out on site. Before taking photographs, they place the geographic targets in appropriate locations, adjust camera settings before and during shooting to suit the light conditions, maintain the required overlap between photos for photo scan, this is 60%, ensure that photos provide enough coverage of the buried remains, continually check the quality of the photos, remove any that are blurry or over or underexposed. Once done taking photos, they survey in the geographic targets with a GPS or a total station, and then record the necessary information on the photogrammetry register. The office workflow is the sequence of tasks the geomatics team follow in the office once on-site procedure is completed. First, we input the site photos into the Wessex folder structure and scan in the photogrammetry register. We then quality check the photos to ensure that they meet criteria required for processing. After that, we input all data from paper registers into our digital photogrammetry rotor. From there, we process the photos in PhotoScan to create a 3D mesh. Once the mesh has been created and referenced, we export certain outputs, which I'll explain in detail in the next few slides. And lastly, the raw photo scan files, object files, or OBJs, orthographic images, and PDFs will all get stored in the site archive. The photo scan processing workflow is as follows. First, we create the mesh in photo scan. Batch processing is also an option to minimize any human intervention during this process. Then we georeference the mesh using georef targets visible on the model and correlating point coordinates taken with a GPS or total station. Once the model has been referenced, we create and export an author mosaic to be inserted into AutoCAD. Lastly, we export an OBJ file for archival purposes and for the creation of various products mentioned more specifically in the next slide. We export two outputs directly from PhotoScan, author mosaics and scaled OBJs, and use them to create products. The author mosaics are inserted into the AutoCAD site plan to create PDFs for the site manager and supervisors to reference. The scaled OBJs are used directly by the PostEx team to analyze and take measurements. This can be done in MeshLab. The OBJs are also used to create videos, time lapses, 3D prints, and for VR creation, and can be uploaded into Sketchfab. These are the products that get disseminated to the client and are used for education and outreach purposes. These products are especially great because they make archaeology accessible to the general public in many different ways. The raw point clouds and meshes generated in PhotoScan are only handled by the geomatics team. So this image is an example of the printable PDFs exported from AutoCAD, which we feed back to the excavation team. And this is one of our more exciting products, a 3D print of the kist found at Sherford, used for exhibitions, education and outreach. 3D prints are great for engaging the public, and they're always incredibly popular. OBJs are also used to create videos. Wessex Archaeology actually has a YouTube channel, so please feel free to visit if you feel so inclined. This particular video is a cluster of buried remains from Castle Coombe, one of our case studies. It was a fascinating example of how graves can become compacted and intercut each other over time. And now V will take you through the case studies.
So the following case studies are examples of sites excavated in the past year while all incomations were fully recorded with photogrammetry. The Bath Abbey footprint is an ongoing project in Bath, and we've recorded 21 buried remains as of May, and the number is steadily increasing. Most recently, lead coffins have been found on site, and as lead is toxic and can be harmful, it is best for the field staff not to touch or disturb them. So using photogrammetry has proven to be the perfect technique implemented to record such objects as it can be computed quickly and accurately from a distance, so it's non-invasive. The image shown is a rendered perspective of two such coffins. Bleeding is a site where 30 buried remains were recorded from September 2017 to January 2018. This plan shows 5 infant burials buried beneath a Roman building as part of a ritual. The building and buried remains were all excavated and processed. processed separately at various stages of the excavation. By revisiting the models of both structure and burials, we were able to understand the relationship in a three-dimensional space and support any architectural interpretations. In this case, the transparency has been applied to the mesh of the building above to reveal the infants buried beneath. The following image is another example of an output that can be produced to support archaeological analysis. This image is a profile cut through the model of the building and shows the depth of the five infant burials highlighted in red relative to the floor level. This perspective shows the infant burials beneath the building within the coordinate system and the orientation of the building relative to north. Christchurch Priory is a site where 26 buried remains were recorded from December 2017 to March 2018. Two trenches were excavated on the grounds of the parish church, revealing buried remains from the early medieval to late medieval period, as illustrated on the time lapse. Just videos are a bit slow at the moment. The early to mid-medieval buried remains were typically in narrow grave cuts, while the mid to late medieval period is characterized by a greater number of stone and graves. But all of these graves have been truncated in some way by later cuts. So Cascoon is a site where 73 buried remains were recorded from November 2017 to February 2018. The excavation focused on a section of the graveyard abutting the north aisle of the parish church. As you can see from the time lapse showing the stratigraphy of the site, the excavated area was very dense. Every burial was recorded using photogrammetry, which was a huge advantage in increasing efficiency and cutting time. So the following image is a short cross-section across the site, and the nature of the site was such that graves were encountered at various levels, surviving to depths of up to 30 centimeters. Intercutting between graves was common, and a few individual profiles are highlighted in the remainder of this. So this image is a comparison study illustrating three things for each case study. The total time spent excavating buried remains, which are represented in the darker colors. The total time spent processing all the models, represented by the lighter shades. And the length of time from the start of the excavation to the beginning of the processing period, represented by the black lines. So with Bleeden and Christchurch in 2017, our original method was to take photos now and process much later. So while we have processed all the models, it was only after the excavation had finished, leaving us unable to provide any relevant feedback to the field staff. So Bleeden in green was processed 2 days after the excavation had finished, and Christchurch in blue was only processed 27 days after the excavation had finished. With Castle Coombe and Bath Abbey, we've improved this methodology to process as our field staff are excavating, allowing us to provide them with the necessary feedback and help build experience. So at Bath Abbey, we started processing 13 days after we started the excavation, and are able to provide our site team with weekly, if not daily, feedback. So if problems occur, they can easily be fixed. So this chart compares the time spent out on site taking photographs in purple, and the time spent processing the models in PhotoScan in blue, with the time spent hand planning on site, which is the purple bottom. So a selection of four burials from each site are represented, as well as the overall average. So as you can see, the time spent taking photographs actually generally ranges from 3 to 30 minutes, depending on site conditions, while hand planning can take between 2 to 4 hours. So this is a significant difference and reinforces the benefit to recording with photogrammetry, especially on large scale sites. Now you notice the photo execution time for Bath Abbey, which is the cluster of bars at the top of the diagram, is slightly longer than the other three case studies. And this is due to the necessary use of a tripod as opposed to handheld photography. Processing time, represented in blue, can take between 1 to 2 hours depending on the number of photographs. However, unlike hand planning, very little human intervention is required during this processing stage. In the past year, out of 328 models, 96.4 have processed successfully. This information is taken from our digital photogrammetry rota. So all the material from the paper registers filled out on the site are transferred to this rota. And once the models start processing, we also note down which stage we're at in the office workflow. And we'll also include any problems or issues that may need to be resolved. So the most commonly occurring problem is insufficient survey data, preventing the models from being referenced. While on the other hand, problems due to photography are actually very rare. So for any problems that still occur, and to hopefully prevent any future issues, we have adopted certain solutions which are being employed or are still in the planning phase. Examples include continuing to provide constructive and timely feedback to the site staff, and to provide training as needed, building their level of experience. If If the site staff are unable or able to view the final models, which they currently aren't able to do, they can gain a better understanding of how their photographs impact the mesh. Introducing a possible distance measurement between geo-reference points as a fail-safe against insufficient survey data. These could be recorded on context sheets. And enabling faster uploads from sites. So the sooner we receive the data, the sooner we can process and provide feedback to the site staff. Over the past year, we've had many successes. We made the method widely accessible to our field staff, and as a result, saw a huge improvement in their photographic skills, which is wonderful to see from a personal perspective. Using photogrammetry has saved project time and money on sites, so it's so quick to do, and provides accurate results. We've improved the accessibility of meshes for the post-ex team, enabling them to import and manipulate accurately referenced OBJs in the mesh lab. So moving forward, we'd like to roll out photogrammetry to more projects to be able to record a wider range of incubations and other features. Archive and storage is a complicated issue, but an ongoing consideration. We can improve the accessibility of 3D models even more beyond mesh lab, which would lead to an increase in education and outreach opportunities. And so there is still room for growth in this exciting field. We'd like to thank everybody who made this presentation possible. And I also want to note that all the background images on the left hand of the slide are all orthographic renders from the 3D models that come from our case studies. So if you have any questions.